Welcome to my review of Siglent's SDG6000X series Arbitrary Waveform Generator. This is Siglent's highest-end wave generator, and it has a 16-bit DAC. Obviously, most people are going to go for the 200 MHz model, but what makes this series interesting is that they have a variant that goes up to 500 MHz. Also, with every variant, you can buy an upgrade that lets you generate IQ signals from the two outputs. I insisted that Siglent send me the 500 MHz version to evaluate because that's a big technical achievement to pull off, especially when you consider Rigol's closest model goes up to 350 MHz and costs a lot more. It almost sounds too good to be true. I'm going to test whether this thing can actually deliver on its claims at 500 MHz, and I think it's safe to assume that if it does, then the lower-end models will also perform just fine. This review is being done under the explicit terms that I can say whatever I want about the product, good or bad. Opening up the box, you get the generator, power, and USB cables. There are also two BNC cables made out of 3D FB coax, which in theory should be a little better than standard RG58. So let's power it up and take a look. One of the first things I noticed is that there's an annoying beeping sound whenever you do anything, and fortunately you can disable it. The screen resolution is 480 by 272, and it's reasonably bright. No problems with viewing angles from the top and the sides, but the colors start looking slightly different when viewed from a sharp angle down below. It's not a problem, everything is still perfectly readable. As you can see, the user interface is fairly plain, but it's easy to read and it's functional. Overall, the screen is way better than the ones used on Siglent's older models. The other important thing to note is that it's a touchscreen. Initially, I found that I was fat-fingering a lot of the button pushes. After I ran the touchscreen calibration routine, things worked a lot better, but it still sometimes feels a little glitchy on the smaller menu options. So it's not perfect, but it's definitely better than no touchscreen, and overall it does make the product easier to use. And in case you're wondering, there are no problems with fingerprints on this screen. As for the physical buttons on the instrument, everything seems fine. The buttons and dial are nice to use, and in general the exterior build quality seems pretty good. I will say this though, I feel like Siglent copied a lot of ideas from Agilent / Keysight. The layout of the controls and ports is very similar. I'm not sure how Keysight feels about this, but from a user's standpoint, this is a good thing because I always really liked my Agilent's interface. Okay, let's start evaluating the performance of the unit. The first thing to highlight is that although this is marketed as a 500 MHz wave generator, this only refers to the sine wave capabilities of the unit. It can do 500 MHz sine waves, but the square wave capabilities top out at 120 MHz. This is a common thing for manufacturers to do nowadays, and if you want to know what it can do with other waveforms, you have to dig into the datasheet. Also, at different frequencies, you get different maximum output voltage swings. For example, at 1 MHz, you can get up to 10 volts peak-to-peak into a 50-ohm load. At 50 MHz, it drops down to 5. And beyond 360 MHz, it drops down to 640 millivolts peak-to-peak. Okay, now let's take a look at the waveform quality. I've got the unit generating two 500 MHz sine waves in antiphase. I've got my scope input set to 50 ohm termination, and as you can see, the quality of the sine waves is surprisingly good at the top end. There does appear to be about 50 picoseconds of lag, but it's hard to say whether this comes from the generator. This could be caused by even a few millimeters of difference in the signal path length. When you're working at radio frequencies, this is the kind of stuff you need to think about. So the sine waves look great, but savvy engineers will know this is not a good test. I'm trying to display a 500 MHz sine wave on a scope with only 500 MHz bandwidth, and I'm also running the signals through several feet of coax, so there's going to be a low-pass filtering effect. The actual waveform may be a lot more jagged and trapezoidal, we just can't see it. So here's a better test where we view the frequency content of the signal with a spectrum analyzer. The setup here is a 12-inch RG316 cable going into an SMA to type N adapter. And I'm generating a 0 dBm sine wave at 500 MHz, which is roughly the maximum you can do. Now we can actually see the distortion in the sine wave. Our second harmonic is about minus 37 dB down, and the third harmonic is about minus 34 dB down. There are a couple of other components, but they're relatively insignificant. Overall, the results are shockingly good. I played around a little bit, searching for the worst-case scenario, and at 400 MHz, I was able to find a harmonic at minus 31.8 dBc. This is several dB better than the datasheet's claim of minus 28 dBc. And for frequencies around 90 MHz, we're looking at about minus 58 dBc. Next, here's a shot of how things look close to the carrier itself with 10 Hz resolution bandwidth. Excellent. It's sharp and stable. And here's another shot at a tighter span. The ARB capability is marketed as 2.4 gig samples per second, so I was kind of worried a 500 MHz sine wave would look more like an ugly triangle wave, but that's not the case. The SDG6000 series spits out very nice sine waves throughout its frequency range. My test results were even better than the claims of the datasheet. But it's not all sunshine and roses. While doing these tests with a spectrum analyzer, I did find a separate issue. When I turn the output of the generator off, you can see we get some signal leakage from the generator at exactly 2.4 GHz, which is most likely a clocking signal. The amplitude is about minus 65 dBm when the output is off, and about minus 72 dBm when the generator is on. It's very weird that it's worse when the output is off. If you plan on working near that frequency, you should be aware of this as you might mistake it for a spectrum analyzer spur. Moving on with performance analysis, Siglent claims rise and fall time edges as fast as a nanosecond. I lack the scope bandwidth to properly verify this claim, but that looks about right. And notice that the edges are fast enough that I'm getting noticeable ringing. At the RF frequencies this thing can do, you're really limited by the cables and accurate impedance matching more than the instrument itself. I already showed you frequency stability on the spectrum analyzer, but in case you're curious, here's an infinite persistence scope view at 1 million waveforms per second. I don't see any jitter issues, but again, you'd need scope bandwidth way higher than 1 GHz to really capture the limitations of the unit. Now I want to start talking about features and operating modes. I found this to be a pleasant surprise. There are a couple of different sweep modes. There's log and linear, and you can change whether it's sweeping upwards in frequency, downwards, or back and forth. I'd imagine audio engineers would have a ton of fun with this. The other thing that really impressed me was that you can generate a square wave, pulse width modulated, then you can change the duty cycle according to pretty much any ramp function you want. So within seconds, you could create something to test the power stage of a Class D amplifier or a motor control circuit. You can do this independently on both channels, and I found no problems with keeping things in phase. In terms of duty cycle limitations, this depends on the frequency you're using. At low frequencies, you can get way below 1%. At 3 MHz, you can just barely get 1 to 99%. And by the time you get up to 120 MHz, you're limited from 40 to 60. I can't imagine this being a problem for anyone, and overall I'm very happy with the PWM and sweeping capabilities of the unit. Next, let's talk about some of the little extra features that you don't get in most wave generators. You can artificially add noise to your signal and pick the signal-to-noise ratio. You can also add harmonics to a signal. I've gotta say, the menu navigation for doing this was pretty awkward, but the on-screen visualization is extremely helpful. You can sum waveforms together and pick what you want to get on the channel output. There's tons more features like this, but I'm not gonna waste your time reading things that you can get from the datasheet. The bulk of this review should be testing and verification. The bottom line is, there's a lot of features. Next, I want to try out some of the modulation options. We've got a lot of different choices here, including phase and frequency shift keying. I think the most fun way to test modulation would be with actual radios, so here's amplitude modulation at around 1 MHz. And frequency modulation at 89 MHz. And yes, I'm intentionally using poor antennas so I don't annoy my neighbors. Now, there's plenty of wave generators on the market that can do all this, but this is where things get interesting. Can the unit do modulation all the way up to 500 MHz? Well, I can't do exactly 500, because then I'd be deviating above the 500 MHz limit. So let's try 499 MHz. I've got my phone connected to the external modulation input, and as you can hear, it's working. Basically, people working in the 433 MHz and 440 MHz bands could get a lot of use out of this thing. Alright, now let's take a look at the arbitrary waveform generation capabilities. There are a massive number of built-in waveforms. I checked them out, and in general they seem to be constructed well. If you want something other than the built-in waveforms, you can use Siglent's EasyWave software. The latest version is a lot better than what Siglent was putting out a few years ago. There are a bunch of different options for hand-drawing waveforms. You can type out parameters for common waveforms, and you can manually type out equations. The software is Visa-based, and in general I found it to be stable. But there is one thing that I felt was missing from what is clearly meant to be a high-end product. You can't copy and paste different waveforms back to back and chain them one after another. You'll have to generate the data points in Excel and import them. I was hoping to do a demo where I reverse engineer a 433 MHz transmitter and clone it, but it's just not practical. Overall, I would describe EasyWave as simple and functional. Next, let's take a look at what makes this product really interesting for RF work. For an extra $669, you can get the option to generate IQ signals. It's pretty easy to do this right off the unit itself, and there's a ton of options ranging from 2ASK to 256 QAM. I've got a demo set up here with an IQ modulator evaluation board from TI. I'm going to use it to generate a 1700 MHz carrier, and then we're going to modulate it with the INQ outputs from the wave generator. The idea is that you can use the unit to generate test signals for RF equipment that you're designing. Here's a shot of 2ASK at 5 megasymbols per second. Here's 8PSK. Here's 16 QAM at 11 megasymbols per second. And the unit maxes out at 256 QAM at 18.75 megasymbols per second. Finally, I want to show you that adjusting the DC offset on the IQ outputs is possible, but only up to 0.25 volts. This may not be enough for some modulator ICs. I also spent some time playing with the EasyIQ software. It's very simple, it's stable, and it gets the job done. Basically, you can think of it as a different interface for changing the IQ settings on the unit. Okay, so what's the final verdict? Overall, it's a hell of a waveform generator. It performed well throughout its frequency range, and it has a very full feature set. It's marketed as an arbitrary waveform generator, but it can replicate a lot of functionality you'd get from a dedicated RF signal generator. The negatives are that the touchscreen is occasionally a bit finicky, and there's some noticeable 2.4 GHz leakage, which may or may not be an issue depending on what you're doing. In terms of performance per dollar versus its peers, the SDG6000X series is going to be pretty hard to beat.